Mama, I am Dr. JO Okunoye, and I'm class advisor and also the lecturer in charge of the course. 1.3, introduction to Pentateuch. And in this course, I'm going to study the meaning of Pentateuch, what Pentateuch is all about. And again, we are going to look at the development of the Pentateuchal criticism. And we are also going to look into the authorship of the Pentateuch, because traditionally it is believed that Moses wrote the books of Pentateuch, Genesis to Deuteronomy. But recently, the claim has been challenged by many scholars. And so as a result of this, we are going to look critically into this, whether Moses wrote the book of Pentateuch or not. And again, we are going to examine each book of the Pentateuch and then the theological messages these books have conveyed and the relevance of these books to us in Africa, and especially at this contemporary period. And so we are going to examine the book of Genesis, the book of Exodus, the book of Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, and bring out their theological messages, what they are trying to pass across even to us now. You know, we are not the original recipients of these messages. Then, if we are not the original authors and recipients of these messages, what are they trying to convey to us in this period, and especially in Africa, in which we belong? I said earlier, what is Pentateuch? First five books of the Bible. But etymologically speaking, where did the word come from? The word Pentateuch.
The Greek word.
The Greek word. Greek word. What?
Pentateuchos.
Pentateuchos. And it means what? Five books, five scrolls. Five means five. Five scrolls, five books. And that refers to the first five books of the Bible, claimed to be written by Moses. Claimed to be written by Moses. The first five books. What is the first book? What?
Genesis.
Genesis. And the second book?
Exodus.
And the last three. Deuteronomy is the last book. After Leviticus, which book again?
Numbers.
Numbers. Is it correct?
Yes.
Well, you have Genesis, you have Exodus, you have Leviticus, you have Numbers, and then you have Deuteronomy. And at the last class, I told you what the book Genesis means from the original text, which is Hebrew. And what is that? Genesis. What does it stand for? The beginning. In the beginning. And in Hebrew, that is called Bereshit. Bereshit. And that is the opening word of Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the hands. Bereshit bara Elohim. And that is the beginning in Hebrew. Bereshit bara Elohim. And so in the Hebrew language, in the Hebrew text of the Bible, it is Bereshit, in the beginning. And that is the name given to the book
of Genesis, the first of the five books classified as Pentateuch. Then Exodus. What is that?
It means Shema. Exodus means Shema. These are the names.
Exodus. Think of it again. Exodus. 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 It means way out. Way out. Way out. Way out. And it is also from the Greek word exodus. Exodus. Ex is a preposition which means house in Greek, and odos means way. Combining the two words, exodus, that is way out. Way out. That is way out of exile, way out of captivity. When they were in Egypt, when they were under Pharaoh, and then they were suffering. Then when they cried to God, God heard them and delivered them and sent somebody to them. Who was that person that God sent to deliver them?
Moses.
Moses was their savior, the deliverer that God sent to deliver the Israelites from the hands of Pharaoh. And then Leviticus. Leviticus in the Hebrew text or in the LXX. What is it?
Vayikra.
Vayikra. And what does that mean?
He called.
Vayikra. He called. So, and when you read Leviticus chapter 1, verse 1, you see that it could mean God. He called himself. And then Numbers. Bimidbar, which means in the wilderness. In the wilderness. And that reminded us of the time when the Israelites, when they moved out from Egypt and they were on their way to the promised land, to Canaan, they were in the wilderness moving towards the promised land. And they spent several years wandering in the wilderness. They were in the wilderness. They experienced a lot of difficulties, a lot of goodness of the Lord too. And the book of Deuteronomy followed immediately after the book of Leviticus. And what does that stand for?
Devarim.
Meaning what?
Works.
These be the works. These are the works. You present it. These are the works. And that is Devarim from the original text from the Hebrew. That is what is called Devarim. And so also, just like your other said, the LXX, the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible, the Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible, also has a way of connoting and then presenting these books to us. And in most cases, the English Bible, the English passages that we are using, mostly copied the text of this LXX, the Septuagint. And then they also refer to Genesis as the book of beginning, and then Exodus, the way out, and then the Leviticus as books pertaining to the Levites, and similarly numbers as that pertain to the numbering or the census, the population that took place when the Israelites on their way even to the promised land. And then Deuteronomy means second law. Deuteronomos, second law. And then we begin to talk about the importance, and relevance of the Pentateuch in Israelite history, which cannot be overemphasized, because the historical framework of the Pentateuch consists mainly of the formation of Israel, the call of Abraham to the death of Moses, the call of Abraham, right from the call of Abraham to the death of Moses, who led the people out of the hands, from the hands of Pharaoh, even to the promised land. So, the Pentateuch again, as we said, can be divided into two main subdivisions. Then we talk about the story of the patriarch. And who are those patriarchs?
Abraham,
Isaac,
Jacob.
Even to Joseph. And Joseph.
Joseph.
And summary, also all the 12 tribes, including all the 12 tribes of Israel. And then the second section relates to the story of Moses, and the formation of the nation Israel. The story of Moses, from the story of Moses to the formation of Israel as a nation, covenanted people of God. So, and that again from Exodus to Deuteronomy, and then Genesis 1:1-11. However, serves as follow to the Pentateuch, and it connects the whole humanity to God's purpose to be fulfilled through Israel. So Genesis 1:1-11. Some we call that as primeval history. Here you read about the creation account, how God created we, human being, how he created the whole universe, living and non-living things, the fall of man, and then when men sin, when we fall from grace to grace, and then the redemption strategies in God put in place to deliver man. And then you also remember the Cain and Abel issue, then what happened, and then the flaw of man, remember, and then the building of Tower of Babel. It goes on like that till God called Abraham. So in summary, we said Pentateuch refers to the first five books of Bible, and it remains a principal text that serves as a veritable source of Israelite history and even the history of humanity as a whole. Not just Israelite history, but the entire history of humanity, of human race as a whole, is found in the Pentateuch. And the books classified in the Pentateuch are Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers and Laws, and Deuteronomy. Besides, Pentateuch was originally written in Hebrew language. Later, it was translated to Greek, especially for the Jews in the diaspora, so that they also benefit and read from the Bible, the text. And then later, it was translated to various languages, as we have it today, even the English version, the Yoruba version, we have the Igbo version of the Pentateuch, and many languages have their own versions of the Pentateuch, and we appreciate God for that. And so, as again we have discussed briefly this morning, we said that the development of Pentateuchal criticism started with the guild of scribes, who actually want to preserve the exact form of the Old Testament. What they wanted was to preserve the exact form of the Old Testament. So, the activities of the Guild of Strife
was the foundation, the beginning of Pentateuch criticism. And this started early enough. And I said, the beginning of scribes, they are also known as Masoretes. They are also known as Masoretes. Known as Masoretes. They are the beginning of scribes. And then they were the custodians. These scribes, they were the custodians of the
sacred
text. They were the custodians of the sacred text, known as the Old Testament. The Old Testament. Not only Pentateuch, but the entire Old Testament. No, we have Pentateuch, we have prophetic literature, we have writings. We have writings. And then under writings, we have poetic books, and then many other literary journey. So that are there for you and I. So, summarily again, from that, we know that criticism in biblical scholarship is the foundation. Just like I told you, that not necessarily when you criticize the Bible, that you want to bring out faults. You know, sometimes we have destructive criticism and we have constructive criticism. When I'm criticizing you to build you up, to say, oh, this is a fault, you have not done this well, but this and this you can do to improve on your performance. So the aim of such criticism is not to destroy you. It's not to run you down, but to build you up. The same thing is applicable when we are talking about biblical criticisms, Pentateuch criticism, which is the affirmation of the claim of people about either a book or an event alluded to in it in the light of archaeological, philological, historical, psychological, and scientific evidences. What are the evidences? Psychologically, archaeologically, historically, to prove that what has been said in the Bible are true. Not to destroy the Bible, but to substantiate it, to make it real to the people, for you to believe more. When the Bible said that David overcame Goliath, and then he cut the neck, he did this, he did that. Again, the archaeology, they've discovered where the battle between David and Goliath, where it happened. And they come to tell us that they will discover the carcass of Goliath's head in that place. That again proves to us that the Bible is real. The information given in the Bible is true. So, what we are looking for by doing criticism is not to destroy the Bible, but to buttress the fact that the Bible is true, the Bible is real, in the light of other evidences, historically, philologically, psychologically, then we come to discover, oh, what the Bible is saying is true. It's just like Yoruba, we say, Afa Soro, Ojo Sekini, Ojoku, Ololon say, Erio. That is when an Afa talk, and then we had the name, the voice, the thunder, coming, say, aha, they have told you, I've said it. So that is what we are trying to do in the Bible. So, summary, Pentateuch criticism began at a very early date. This is evident in the works of the Masoretes, who aimed at restoring original reading of the text. However, from the 18th century AD, Pentateuch criticism assumed a new dimension. And the pioneer of modern critical study of Pentateuch is German named J.G. Akron. J.G. what? That is the father of new modern criticism of the Pentateuch. Thank you. God bless you. Any question?